Hello, I'm John Sanders alongside Aaron Sanderson, and welcome to today's webinar. Today we'll be talking about technical solutions that can accommodate people with MS and ALS in the workplace. So without further ado, let's begin. First, I want to highlight why we at CAP care about this issue. CAP stands for the Computer Electronic Accommodations Program. And we're a part of the Department of Defense, and our mission is to provide equal access to information and opportunities in the federal government. We do this by helping to identify appropriate solutions for each individual based on their job and the limitations they're experiencing, and providing these solutions to federal employees with disabilities and active duty wounded service members. For this reason, we'll be focusing on workplace accommodations during our discussion today. To start, I'd like to take a moment to discuss each of these conditions, starting with ALS. ALS stands for Amyotrophic Lateral Sclerosis, which is often referred to as Lou Gehrig's disease. It's a progressive neurodegenerative disease that attacks the nerve cells responsible for controlling voluntary muscle movement. Essentially, as these motor neurons degenerate and die, there's a disruption of the signal from the brain to the muscles, and it eventually leads to the loss of the brain's ability to control those muscle movements. Early symptoms often include increasing muscle weakness, especially involving the arms or the legs, but it can eventually get to where it affects speech, swallowing, or even breathing. Most commonly, it's diagnosed in people between 40 and 60 years old, so the symptoms typically present around the same time as other causes may, including acquired disabilities or symptoms simply attributed to the aging workforce. Multiple sclerosis, which is commonly abbreviated as MS, is a chronic disease of the central nervous system. It causes the destruction of myelin, which surrounds and protects nerve fibers located in the central nervous system. Signals traveling through the nerve fibers are then interrupted or delayed, and they cause neurological symptoms in various parts of the body. Symptoms can range in severity, but often the first symptom is blurred or double vision, but it can also result in pain or loss of vision because of inflammation of the optic nerve. Other symptoms may include muscle weakness, tightness in the limbs, spasticity, which is a tightness or stiffness of the muscles, loss of coordination, muscle cramps, or even paralysis. Additionally, roughly half of individuals diagnosed with MS experience cognitive impairments such as difficulty with concentration, attention, or memory. However, these symptoms are usually mild and often go overlooked. Usually, the first symptoms of MS present themselves between ages of 20 to 40. So, now that we have an understanding of what may be experienced by an individual diagnosed with MS or ALS, we'd like to look at some assistive technology options for people with these symptoms that they can utilize in the workplace. To go over that with us, we have Aaron Sanderson. Aaron works in CAP's Technology Evaluation Center in the Pentagon, which showcases this type of technology. Aaron?
Thanks, John. So as John mentioned, I'm going to review some common assistive technologies for individuals with MS or ALS. First, it's important to start with a good ergonomic workstation. This is the foundation for an accessible work environment. Tools that will allow for a proper ergonomic workstation can include a number of different solutions, one of which are alternative pointing devices. These are an alternative to a standard mouse. So to use a standard mouse, a person must reach laterally while moving their arm and wrist to control the mouse. For some individuals with MS or ALS, these are difficult and sometimes impossible to use. So alternative mice may be an option. A couple of these different types of mice include a trackball mouse. These are set up like upside down mice with an exposed protruding ball. The user can roll the ball with their thumb, fingers, or the palm of their hand to control the mouse. Vertical mice. These are very similar to a standard mouse, but the controls are on the side. This is designed to keep the user's hand in a natural position. And finally, roller mice. Now, this is a bar that's located in front of the keyboard where all of the features are located. It's controlled using a rotating cylinder, and this mouse completely eliminates the need to reach laterally to control the mouse. Like the standard mouse, the standard keyboard may also be difficult for someone with MS or ALS to use. This could be due to shaking, numbness, or loss of coordination. So alternative keyboards may help, and there are many on the market with different features. So a few different options include a keyboard with larger keys, a keyboard with a key guard to prevent the wrong keys from being pressed, and ergonomic keyboards which would allow the individual to keep their arms, wrists, and hands in a natural position when keyboarding. Perhaps a person's limitations are so significant that using a keyboard and mouse are not possible. For ALS, this could be the result of muscle weakness, and for MS, this could be the result of numbness in the limbs, loss of coordination, muscle weakness, tightness, and tremors. So in this case, speech recognition software may be appropriate. Speech recognition software would allow the user to control their computer using their voice. Virtually anything that can be done with a keyboard and mouse can be done using verbal commands. This includes creating documents, writing emails, and browsing the web. And finally, if an individual with ALS or MS finds it difficult to sit or stand for long periods of time due to muscle weakness, numbness, or pain, sit-to-stand equipment may allow them to work for longer periods of time by allowing them to change positions throughout the day. Now, there are many sit-to-stand options available on the market. Some of these are adjustable desks, attachments to desks, or their own unit that sits on the desk surface. They are also available with the ability to adjust the height both manually or using a motorized unit.
And with the way that these conditions affect muscle movement, it's completely understandable why tools that assist with the physical interactions of the job are most prevalent. But do you think you could touch on technology that could also benefit an individual experiencing some of the other potential symptoms?
Sure. So for MS, one of the common symptoms is visual difficulties. If a person is experiencing problems with their vision, tools such as screen magnification software or desktop or portable closed-circuit televisions or CCTVs may be helpful. Screen magnification software would allow the user to increase the size of the information on the screen, adjust the color contrast to reduce the glare in their eyes, customize the pointer and cursor to make them easier to see, and it even has a feature which will read information on the computer aloud. CCTVs are used to magnify hard copy documents or objects with small print. They also have features that can adjust color contrast and brightness. Now, these can be a large unit the size of a computer that sits on the desk surface, or small portable devices that can be taken to meetings or trainings. For both ALS and MS, speech can often be affected. So if creating the necessary volume is an issue, voice amplification devices would allow the individual to adjust the volume of their speech to ensure that they are communicating effectively and can be heard. These can help amplify the user's voice both in person, but there are also devices available to help amplify the user's voice over the phone. For some individuals, verbal communication may not be possible. So for them, augmentative communication devices would allow them to communicate in other ways. So for some, it may be a communication board. For others, systems may be created to allow them to communicate using a computer or other device. Augmentative communication devices are individualized products that are unique to each person and how it is best for them to interact with it depending on their motor skills. So these can be controlled using their fingers, their hands, or even their eyes. As John mentioned, for MS, cognitive functions may be impaired. So to help with this, memory and cueing devices would allow the individual to process information easier, remind them of tasks and deadlines, stay organized, and continue to be productive. A couple of solutions that could help include smartphones. Now, these are tools that many people already have. Smartphones feature tools such as voice notes, reminders, task lists, and calendar features. And if needed, there are even reference guides available to teach a person how to make the best use of the features that their phones already have. Another solution may be a recording pen. This would allow an individual to capture information in meetings, trainings, or during courses without missing any pertinent information. And finally, some people may find it easier to process information if they can both see it and hear it simultaneously. To help, there are software programs available that will read everything on the computer aloud.
That's great information, Aaron, and thank you for sharing. As useful as it is to know an array of items that can assist with different types of difficulties that an individual may be having in the workplace, it can be hard to match up the correct technology with what they are experiencing to have it be an effective solution. For that, CAP uses a needs assessment system where we focus on 1, the job, 2, the individual, and 3, the solution. As Aaron just mentioned, we're only highlighting a couple of things in a broad categories of assistive technology. With so many products available, there's so many symptoms that may be experienced. This is how we determine what the most effective tool may be for an individual in their specific situation. To make this a little more practical, Aaron and I would like to give an example of how this three-pronged approach can assist people in identifying which of the solutions just mentioned may be best in their unique case. Aaron?
So as John mentioned, the first thing we want to look at is the job. In this scenario, the individual is a federal civilian employee who works as legal counsel for a government agency. The position involves significant amounts of reading, writing, and telephone use. The reading duties can be both electronic documents or research, as well as hard copy files. And finally, this individual is required to attend meetings. Most meetings involve high-level staff in different locations and are conducted over the phone or video teleconference.
Next, we want to look at the individual. When looking at the individual, it's important to understand that multiple people may have the same diagnosis. However, most people don't experience that diagnosis in the same way. People may have varying symptoms, so it's really important to ask questions and understand exactly what each person is experiencing, how it is affecting them, and what the prognosis is. In other words, what do we anticipate happening in the future? In this scenario, the individual was recently diagnosed with MS. Current symptoms include muscle weakness, which was causing difficulty completing computer tasks when typing and using the mouse. He also experienced numbness in fingers and toes, which constantly resulted in him pushing the wrong key or double typing single letters. He also had difficulty speaking at a volume that could be perceived by others, both in person and on the phone. And finally, he was experiencing some decreased vision, which makes it difficult to review hard copies and electronic documents. The final step when learning about the individual is to know what their prognosis is. Symptoms may get better, they could stay the same, or continue to deteriorate. What works one day may not work the next, so knowing the prognosis will help determine the most appropriate tools. The prognosis for this individual is that his muscle weakness would continue to get worse, most likely, but his voice and vision were expected to stay about the same. Overall, this employee wanted to continue working as a lawyer and asked for some reasonable accommodations that would assist him with the difficulties he was having. He was very comfortable with assistive technology and was willing to try anything that would bridge the gap between his job functions and his limitations. So now that we know about the job and the individual, I'll ask Aaron to show how we can use this information to find the best solutions.
So to find potential solutions, we want to look for tools that can assist with the limitations he's experiencing as a result of MS. To help with this employee's muscle weakness and numbness in their fingers, there are a few tools that may help. First is speech recognition software. This would allow the employee to speak to control his computer with his voice instead of having to type or use a standard mouse. Next is an alternative keyboard and key guard. This would prevent the employee from accidentally hitting the wrong keys when using the keyboard for sensitive information he could not speak out loud. These are things like passwords. To help with his difficulty speaking at a volume that could be heard by others, 2 types of voice amplifiers would help this employee. First is an inline amplifier connected to his phone. Now this would allow him to increase the volume of his voice over the phone so he can be heard by others who are on those conference calls that he's on. Second is an in-person amplifier. Now this would amplify the sound of his voice to people he met with in person. To pair the amplifier and the speech recognition software, there is a headset with a switch box. Now, a headset is needed for both the speech recognition software as well as for the use of the voice amplifier. A switch box would allow the employee to use a single headset and switch from dictating to his computer to speaking on the phone without having to change headsets or picking up and holding a standard phone handset. The final limitation that the employee experiences is decreased vision. So for this, screen magnification would allow him to manipulate the color combination and the size of material on his computer screen. And if his eyes are fatigued and he finds it easier to have information read aloud to him, the software has a reader tool which will do just that. Next is a closed circuit television. This employee spends the majority of his day seated at his desk. Therefore, a desktop CCTV would be the best option. It would allow him to magnify and change the color combination of hard copy documents. It would also provide the ability for him to split the screen and view electronic and hard copy documents in a large size and in the best color combination as possible, all on the same screen. The final step in accommodating this employee is verifying that all of these tools will work on the network and are approved for use in his work environment. Now in this case, the local IT staff confirms that all of the software or items presented to the employee are allowed for use on the network and, if agreed upon by the customer, could be implemented as a solution. These tools were allowed in the environment and allowed the individual to bridge the gap between his job functions and his limitations to allow him to continue to work and to succeed.
Thank you so much, Erin. And I think that's a great example of how the CAP needs assessment process can ensure the correct solutions are identified for an individual based on what they're experiencing, and ensuring the best options are presented from a sea of available technology solutions. Before we wrap up, I just want to highlight a couple of resources for you, especially in terms of assistive technology and how it interacts with the computer. The first is CapTech. This is our technology center in the Pentagon where Erin works full-time, and they can provide in-person needs assessments, distance-based assessments through phone or video teleconference, and be a resource for anyone looking for an assistive technology solution. I'd encourage you to check out our website as well, which is cap.mil. There are a lot of resources on the site, and you can browse assistive technology, receive up-to-date disability employment information, and technology updates. If you have a specific question, you're always more than welcome to just email us directly at cap@mail.mil. I'd also encourage you to check out our YouTube channel. Not only are there assistive technology videos that show demonstrations of some technology that Erin highlighted, but there are also testimonial videos, one of which is an individual named Judy Summers Gates, who was diagnosed with MS and works for the Food and Drug Administration. So looking at the testimonial and the technology videos, you can kind of see how we utilize the process in her specific instance to find tools that help her in the workplace. So feel free to check out any of those videos at www.youtube.com/theDODCAP. In closing, I just want to say thank you for participating in today's webinar. If you have any questions or need additional information, feel free to contact us by phone at 703-614-8416 or by email. If you're interested in viewing previous webinars or looking at a list of upcoming topics, please visit the Training and Outreach section of our website at cap.mil. On behalf of myself and Erin Sanderson, thank you for participating in today's webinar.